Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. If I could have your attention, please. Thank you. It is my sincere pleasure to welcome all of you to the United Nations Headquarters High-Level Symposium on Synergies along the Silk Road for the Agenda 2030. My name is Melike Ayan, and I'm the financial news reporter with Bloomberg TV, and I will be your mistress of ceremonies today. Thank you so much for joining us here today on what is a very special occasion for Turkic World Educational and Scientific Cooperation Organization, TÜESKO. TÜESKO is an international institution that promotes and coordinates the enhancement of scientific and educational cooperation among Turkic-speaking nations. Not only this is the first symposium organized by TÜESKO and its partners at the United Nations, but also it is the first remarkable event that it has had the honor to have the attendance of the President of the United Nations ECOSOC, His Excellency Mr. Ojun, Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs of Kazakhstan, His Excellency Mr. Yarjan Ashigabey, permanent representatives of various countries to the United Nations, ambassadors, top executives of international organizations, and distinguished scholars and intellectuals. Thus, it really does represent a milestone. Seeing all of you here at this prestigious and unique event, jointly organized with the permanent missions of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Turkey to the United Nations, and supported by the international organizations of the Turkic Council, TurkSoy, Turkic Culture and Heritage Foundation, Michigan State University, Hazar Strategy Institute, and especially thanks to TIKA and Presidency for Turks Abroad and Related Communities. They all make me realize just what an exceptional community we can create globally. The ancient Silk Road. The Silk Road connects the old world all the way from China and India to Europe and the Mediterranean Sea, forming a bridge between the East and the West. Being at the heart of the Silk Road, the countries of Central Asia and Caucasus are interested in the revival of the Great Silk Road and achieving sustainable economic development, political stability, culture of peace and tolerance, and good neighborly relations are one of the missions. The region has undergone significant transformation in terms of integration to regional and global economies. Energy-rich states of the region have managed to attract impressive foreign and domestic investments and developed expertise and skills to enhance knowledge-based economy. This high-level meeting aims to discuss ways to maximize the development impact of the Silk Road in support of Agenda 2030. During the symposium, the global impact of the activities carried out throughout the Silk Road will be discussed. Furthermore, it will provide an opportunity to address concerns related to transnational challenges that can derail peace and progress across many regions. The gathering will thus serve as a platform for exchange of views by policymakers and academicians on issues of relevance to the United Nations. This symposium will be divided into two panels, each one discussing specific aspects of the ancient and modern Silk Road. Speakers and discussants will focus on ways of enhancing global peace and security on the Silk Road and beyond, reaching UN's sustainable development goals through endorsing the Silk Road. The emphasis will also be on the global threats of epidemics, transnational crime, violent extremisms, terrorism, the forced displacement of people, and natural disasters. In a globalized world, the Silk Road and its multidimensional influences have global ramifications. And so this symposium will be of great relevance for the entire United Nations community. Besides the official opening and substantive segments, this symposium will also have an award ceremony at which Nobel Prize laureate Professor Aziz Sancar, renowned U.S. Turkic studies scholars Professor Kemal Karpat, and Professor Edward Allworth will be recognized by the International Turkic Academy for their outstanding work with a medal. With us this morning are so many eminent guests, our UN executives and co-chairs, without whom this morning and afternoon would not have been possible. Thank you all so much for joining us on this special occasion, and ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming His Excellency Mr. Oh Jun, President of the United Nations ECOSOC, to give his welcoming remarks. Thank you, Excellency, for this event at this amazing ECOSOC Chamber Salon.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, I would like to congratulate the permanent missions of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Turkey, as well as the International Turkic Academy for organizing this very important symposium. September 2015 was a historic moment for mankind. A record number of heads of state and government gathered here in New York to formally adopt the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development at the United Nations Summit. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development was a triumph for humanity at a critical time in our history. Representatives of all countries, civil society, and stakeholders worked closely together with a spirit of unity, guided by the common vision of a just, sustainable, and safe world for current and future generations. The Agenda 2030 is a transformative and very ambitious blueprint for socio-economic development. Most importantly, it is tangible and implementable. The agenda consists of 17 ambitious Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs, and 169 targets, all committing ourselves to leaving no one behind. The SDGs and targets build on the achievements of the MDGs and aim not only to complete their unfinished business, but also to take a giant step forward. The SDGs tackle critical and persistent global challenges such as poverty, hunger, education, inequalities, health, and water and sanitation. There are new goals dealing with unemployment, economic growth, industrialization, and infrastructure, which are essential for sustainable development for all. In short, the 17 Sustainable Development Goals observe socio-economic goals in a single agenda that also addresses the environment. They constitute a comprehensive, far-reaching, and people-centered set of universal aspirations representing our promise to uplift vulnerable people and communities everywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, as our world is in transition, and the international community is striving for a more sustainable and equitable path to development, the countries along the Silk Road have a unique role to play in advancing the 2030 Agenda. Central Asia is a vast region consisting of countries with distinct characteristics such as culture, religion, and history, both common and individual. It is an ancient crossroads of cultures and ideas that continues to be a key player on the global stage. As such, a lasting legacy of the Silk Road has been its role in bridging cultures and peoples in contact with each other, facilitating exchange between them, and promoting respect and understanding. Some Central Asian countries that are landlocked might face constraints on their efforts to achieve sustainable development. The Vienna Program of Action for Landlocked Countries together with the 2030 Agenda and the Addis Ababa Action Agenda, recognize their challenges and offer holistic solutions for them. The SDGs also offer the tools to overcome obstacles in achieving a sustainable future for all. The countries along the Silk Road can seize the opportunity offered by the SDGs to explore new pathways for economic interaction, as well as strengthen old business ties with neighboring and distant countries. In closing, I would like to assure you that ECOSOC will continue its part in supporting the implementation of the SDGs, as well as building a robust review framework on our commitments. In particular, the High-Level Political Forum, or HLPF, under the auspices of ECOSOC, will have a central role in overseeing a network of follow-up and review processes at the global level. I look forward to your active participation during the forum to share your lessons learned and challenges in implementing the new 2030 Agenda from all of your countries and region. I'm confident that you can help shape not only a stronger region, but a better world for all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ojun, for your welcoming remarks. And now I'd like to introduce you to His Excellency Yarjan Ashikbayev, Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs from the Republic of Kazakhstan. He will deliver a welcoming address by the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan, Nursultan Nazarbayev.
Thank you. Excellencies, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, first let me thank you, each of you, for making it to this important conference on Easter Sunday, on a rainy morning, and warm welcome to all of you. And let me pass on to the message, a welcoming address by the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan, Mr. Nursultan Nazarbayev. To the participants of the International Symposium on the theme Synergies Along the Silk Road for Agenda 2030. Dear participants of the symposium, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, recently adopted by the United Nations, sets out commitments to the promotion of peace, the progress of humanity, protection of the environment, and the eradication of poverty. Kazakhstan is also making a substantial contribution to the common prosperity of all humankind. Having refused nuclear arsenal in the early days of its independence, Kazakhstan has since then launched a number of initiatives related to security issues. In today's turbulent times, the expansion of terrorism and extremism in some parts of the world is recognizable. It is therefore our common responsibility to prevent new threats and to stand jointly against them. Civil society organizations and scholars, experts and specialists should come together to meet these challenges. In this regard, I believe that the symposium held by the International Turkic Academy at the United Nations headquarters encourages concord among civilizations and nations and boosts the solidification of mutual trust. I wish the symposium great success. Nursultan Nazarbayev. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ashikbayev, for these welcoming remarks from Nursultan Nazarbayev, the President of the Republic of Kazakhstan. And now I'd like to invite the permanent representative of the Republic of Turkey to the United Nations, His Excellency Mr. Yaşar Halit Çevik, to give the welcoming messages, the remarks from the Prime Minister of Turkey.
Değerli hocalarımız, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you all to this important symposium. I believe today's discussions will contribute to our work in reviving the ancient Silk Road and making it a functional and critical network. It will also be instrumental in identifying the areas it would contribute to the implementation of 2030 agenda. Before conveying the message of by Prime Minister Ahmet Davutoğlu, I would like to express our deepest condolences to the brotherly people and government of Pakistan for the terrorist attacks in Lahore yesterday. Our hearts and thoughts are with Lahore and Pakistan today. We condemn in strongest terms these acts and we stand firm with them in our common fight against this scourge. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to read the message by Prime Minister Ahmet Davutoğlu, and I quote, "Dear participants, I have received with pleasure the invitation to attend the symposium entitled Synergies Along the Silk Road for Agenda 2030, taking place at the United Nations headquarters in New York. I am confident that the symposium will serve as a useful and timely contribution to the efforts for bringing out our region's immense potential along the ancient Silk Road for the mobilization of economic, human, cultural resources between Asia and Europe, as well as elaborating on the projects with a view to revitalizing the ancient Silk Road. I very much regret that I will be unable to attend the symposium owing to my previous engagements. However, Turkey strongly supports the initiative in line with its attachment to the goals of sustainable development, in addition to its natural close cooperation with the countries of the Silk Road, based on the socio-cultural and historical affinity. Let me congratulate the International Turkic Academy for organizing such a timely event at this crucial conjuncture and express my confidence for its success. With best regards, Ahmet Davutoğlu, Prime Minister of the Republic of Turkey," unquote. And I thank you.
Thank you, His Excellency. Great messages from both countries for the cooperation of the Turkic countries and for today's agenda. And now I'd like to introduce you to Madame Nihal Saad, the Chief of Cabinet and Spokesperson for the United Nations High Representative for the Alliance of Civilizations. She will deliver the welcoming address by Under Secretary General of the UN, High Representative for the Alliance of Civilizations, His Excellency Mr. Nasir Abdulaziz Al-Nasir.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm honored to address this important symposium on behalf of the High Representative for the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations, His Excellency Mr. Nasir Abdulaziz Al-Nasir. He's sending his best regards to the audience and to the participants of this important symposium. Here is the message of the High Representative. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, I would like to thank you for inviting the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations to this timely symposium. Let me begin by recognizing the significant role that the hosts of this meeting are playing in advancing the agenda of the United Nations in general and the 2030 agenda in particular. The hosts, namely the Turkic-speaking states of Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan, and Turkey. The United Nations of Alliance of Civilizations is proud of its partnership and close cooperation with each of these countries at the government level and at the non-governmental level. It goes without saying that Turkey, a main co-sponsor of the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations, stands out for its political and financial support of the Alliance since its inception. Our cooperation with the government of Azerbaijan started a few years back, and it continues to grow stronger as our 7th Global Forum is around the corner this coming April in Baku, Azerbaijan. Kazakhstan is one of the key players in the region in the area of strengthening the role of religious leaders in promoting dialogue for peace, and I had the honor to participate in the Congress of Leaders of World and Traditional Religions this past June. And we are preparing to welcome Kyrgyzstan as the newest member of the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations Group of Friends, and we look forward to our mutual collaboration. We are truly living in a dynamic moment in history. It would be stating the obvious to say that sustainable development is essential to maintaining global peace and security. The process of globalization is transforming societies, making them increasingly diverse and interconnected. Vast new opportunities for exchange between different people and diverse cultures arose. The crisis that shook the global economy since 2008 has accelerated the rise of culture in development policies. Governments worldwide must rethink strategies for growth and seek to identify new sources of vitality. The adoption by the United Nations member states of the historic and transformative 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development last September puts forward ambitious development goals for all countries and provides new opportunities and new paths for international development cooperation. As such, the revival of the Silk Road offers the perspective of new dynamics that extend beyond Central Asia and the Caucasus. The two edges of the ancient Silk Road were Europe and China. The new Silk Road connects Asia's Far East and Africa. What is of utmost significance here is that behind the economic cooperation entailed in the Silk Road is the dialogue at work between diverse civilizations and cultures, that of Europe, Asia, Eurasia, and Africa. In a world threatened today by the clash of civilizations and the clash of ignorance, the synergies along the Silk Road is the demonstration that cultures can cross-fertilize. I believe that the new Silk Road is also an anticipation of new productive exchanges and encounters and the promise of future harmonies. End of the message of His Excellency, Mr. Nasser Abdelaziz al-Nasser, the United Nations Alliance of Civilizations High Representative. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Madame Nihal Saad, for His Excellency Al-Nasir's messages. And now I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Eric Adams from the Brooklyn Borough. He is the president of Brooklyn Borough. He's among us. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. And I bring greetings to you from the people of New York and the Borough of Brooklyn as the chief executive of the Borough of Brooklyn, where 47% of Brooklynites speak a language other than English at home. We are truly the modern Silk Road of America. Roads play two important roles. One, the physical presence of the actual structure. Two, the spiritual, emotional presence that is global. I'm going to challenge all of us to expand the concept of the Silk Road, to allow the emotional aspect of the road to expand across waters, across seas, and into all communities. The historical physical presence of the road that included China, India, Turkey, Persia, which is now Iran, was important during the historical times. Now it's time for us to go beyond. Our neighbors are no longer the countries who are next door. Our neighbors are now the countries that are across the globe. We are all united as one source of humanity. And it is that mental concept of going beyond where we are physically and understanding that the role of humanity is going to depend on our ability to reach beyond our comfort zones. We say it over and over again. We have a unified fight against terrorism, a fight against ignorance, a fight against those who are leaving their homelands because of oppression to find freedom somewhere. That's the call today as this important conference of synergy. It is the energy that will come from our response to how do we ensure that humanity rises together. On the Silk Road of modern times, it must include a place for women so that they know they have a role in our future. It must include a place from those who are fleeing and are now refugees across the globe, that it appears as though Turkey is the only country that understands the significance of this. We must all join Turkey in ensuring that all refugees have a home. It must include economic development and finding ways to ensure that not only our scientific discoveries go to profit-making, but to ensure that fresh water and other forms of lifestyle is improved. So we want to build a new Silk Road where we are all neighbors, where we will all live on the road together, and the road will take us to a destination of ensuring that we are all people of humanity, mindful, thoughtful, compassionate, caring, and greatest members of the greatest race alive, and that's the human race. Let's make sure that road is prosperous for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, President Adams. It couldn't have been put well in terms of the functions and the importance of the modern Silk Road. Thank you again. And now I'd like to introduce you to Mr. David Harris, the Chief Executive Officer of AJC.
Good morning, and thank you very much to the sponsors, beginning with the International Turkic Academy. Thank you to the four missions from Azerbaijan, a country we visited just 2 weeks ago when we had the privilege of meeting President Aliyev in Baku, of Kazakhstan, of Kyrgyzstan, and of Turkey for bringing us all together. Ladies and gentlemen, the permanent representative of Turkey appropriately mentioned the horror in Lahore yesterday. I was in Brussels on the day of the attack there. And the horror that we speak about in Lahore or in Brussels or elsewhere is a common horror, one that we must all fight against. The agenda of the United Nations for the year 2030 fights against it, because those who would attack innocent people in Lahore or in Brussels or elsewhere are seeking to divide humanity, whether along race, religion, ethnicity, or belief. We stand together in our determination to unite humanity. And the Silk Road is one such mechanism for doing precisely that. The Silk Road fires the imagination of those of us who have studied history. It takes us back 2,200 years to an idea perhaps that began in commerce but moved far beyond the commercial trade, because it introduced religions to one another. The great religions of the world encountered each other along the Silk Road. Buddhism, Christianity, Judaism, Zoroastrianism, Islam from the 7th century on. It brought together not just religions, but cultures. It shared ideas and innovations. It created a two-way road, indeed, a road with multiple directions. And now, thanks to the imagination of some modern-day believers, we are recreating the Silk Road and we are expanding it. And the world needs it now more than it has needed it in many a year. At the American Jewish Committee, with institutes focused on Asia, on Africa, and on Europe, we are determined on the NGO track to be part of this effort and part of the solution. The goals of the Sustainable Development Program really are reduced to, if you will, in mathematical terms, P to the power of 5. We are talking about peace. We are talking about people. We are talking about our planet. We are talking about partnerships among nations. And yes, we are talking about prosperity, all of which together, if we can achieve these goals, working harmoniously, will indeed contribute not just to the sustainability of our planet, but to ensuring that those who would divide us, those who would kill innocent people, including children, in the name of some demented belief system or ideology, will not win. The Silk Road of today will help ensure that by helping to unite our world. Thank you. It's an honor for AJC to be part of this occasion.
Thank you, Mr. David Harris. Thank you for coming and being part of this event. And now I'd like to read out the welcoming address by Madame Marie Paul Rodil, Head of UNESCO Liaison Office. Excellences, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, I would like to thank and congratulate the permanent missions of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan and Turkey for convening this relevant event that will address the pertinent contribution of the Silk Road to the new development agenda. The 2030 development agenda is for the people, from the people, and by the people. Major challenges for its implementation would require new forms of cultural diplomacy, as well as deepening the ties between peoples and across cultures through respect and mutual understanding. After 70 years of experience and existence, UNESCO's experience shows more than ever the need for an intellectual and moral solidarity for humanity. Today, human rights and development must be our starting point, and dialogue must be our most powerful tool. By an initiative of Kazakhstan, 2 years ago, the United Nations General Assembly launched a decade of rapprochement of cultures, and UNESCO has been appointed as a lead agency in coordinating the decade's activities. As such, we are advancing on new avenues, notably with regard to a process of ambitious research on indicators to explore and cement linkages between intercultural dialogue and sustainable development. In this framework, we will be providing capacity building to promote intercultural competencies with a view to strengthening cultural literacy. We are working on awareness, raising diverse outreach initiatives. We are aware that the implementation of such initiatives will gain from enhanced synergies in approaches and methodologies. UNESCO will therefore continue to seek creative and innovative collaboration with its member states, as well as with important actors and partners for furthering the goal of the rapprochement of cultures decade, which is to illustrate the benefits of jointly promoting respect for human rights and cultural diversity while acknowledging the importance of intercultural and interreligious dialogue to fight against new forms of racism, discrimination, intolerance, extremisms, and radicalization, thus forging ties among peoples and nations. Linking this to the Silk Road that you will be discussing today, I would like to emphasize that already in 1988, UNESCO launched a project entitled The Integral Study of the Silk Roads, or Roads of Dialogue, as part of the organization's effort to promote mutual understanding and intercultural dialogue. The project mobilized renowned experts and specialists through scientific expeditions, research, and international exchanges in order to shed light on the rich common heritage developed along the legendary land and maritime Silk Routes. Its findings highlighted that the Silk Roads were considered as the oldest and longest routes of dialogue. These roads have played a major role in the cultural, political, military, economic, religious, scientific, and artistic transformations that took place in major centers of civilizations in different continents. As Professor Valerie Hansen points out, trade was not the primary purpose of the network. Instead, the Silk Road changed history largely because of the people who managed to travel along or part of all the Silk Road, who planted their cultures like seeds of exotic species carried to the distant lands. Therefore, more than a commercial route, the Silk Road became the planet's most famous cultural artery for the exchange between religions, art, sciences, languages, and technologies. Ladies and gentlemen, building on the experience acquired through the project which ended in 2011, UNESCO initiated the Silk Road online platform in 2012 to promote and disseminate the knowledge developed on the Silk Road by UNESCO and its partners. This new initiative seeks to enhance dialogue and exchange between different stakeholders along the historical Silk Roads. Today's event will no doubt facilitate discussion of how the United Nations member states along the Silk Roads could use this common heritage to promote peace, stability, and sustainable development. Thank you, and this is from Mrs. Marie-Paul Rogel, Director of the UNESCO. And now I'd like to invite the Counselor of Permanent Republic and Representatives of People, Republic of China, Mrs. Mei Lu.
Hi, good morning. Your Excellencies, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mei Lu. I'm coming from Chinese Mission, People's Republic of China to the United Nations. And I'm honored to attend today's symposium. And first, let me thank the host for organizing this symposium. And in September last year, the United Nations Summit adopted the post-2015 development agenda, which we call 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda, which gives guidance to the international development cooperation for the next 15 years. And today we get together to discuss how countries along the Silk Road strengthen our cooperation to implement this 2030 agenda, which we believe will make a significant contribution to both regional and international development cooperation. Since ancient times, the Silk Road has played a significant role in strengthening cooperation across the Eurasia continent and promote exchanges between the East and West in many ways, as previous speakers mentioned. And in recent years, the Silk Road has been revitalizing with the joint efforts of countries along the Silk Road. And many regional cooperation initiatives and mechanisms have been flourished. In 2013, Chinese President Xi Jinping proposed the building of Silk Road Economic Belt and 21st Century Maritime Silk Road, which is called the Belt and Road Initiatives. And this initiative had brought regional cooperation to a new level. So I would like to take this occasion to make a few points regarding the Belt and Road Initiative and the implementation of 2030 agenda. First, the principle and characteristics of the Belt and Road Initiative is wide consultation, joint contribution, and shared benefits. The Belt and Road Initiative is China's initiative, but it belongs to the world. President Xi stressed on many occasions that the Belt and Road Initiative is not closed and exclusive, but open and inclusive. It's not China's solo, but a chorus of all countries along the routes. Such emphasis embodies an important principle guiding the Belt and Road Initiative and resonates with China's philosophy of fostering a new paradigm of international relations featuring win-win cooperation. So let me just briefly explain the principles. So wide consultation is about taking in ideas and wisdom of all relevant countries along the roads and accommodates their interests and concerns. In the process of implementing the initiative, China consulted with all countries along the routes and taking a lot of constructive advices and suggestions on board. Joint contribution means participation of all countries with diverse reality and different development levels. Their respective strengths and potentials will form a unique synergy for greater cooperation in the region. Shared benefits is about mutual benefits and win-win cooperation among the countries. Such cooperation will bring real benefits to not only the relevant countries and people, but to the larger international community. Second, we believe the Belt and Road Initiatives offers important vehicle and platform for participating countries to synergize their implementation of 2030 agenda, which will make major contribution to regional cooperation and to wider international community. The five cooperation priority areas of the Belt and Road Initiatives are namely policy coordination, infrastructure connectivity, trade facilitation, financial integration, and people-to-people exchanges. These five priority areas all converge with the priority areas of 2030 agenda. And in 2030 agenda, it encourages all regions strengthen cooperation to implement the agenda, building on existing regional mechanisms and initiatives, taking into consideration of regional characteristics and dynamics. Therefore, countries along the Silk Road should make best use of the Road and Belt initiatives for more successful and efficient implementation of 2030 agenda. For example, we could strengthen cooperation in infrastructure for greater regional connectivity to bring countries along the routes together. We could strengthen economic integration so as to improve supply, create demand, and promote sustained, inclusive, sustainable economic growth, industrialization in the region. This in itself could be major achievement to the implementation of 2030 agenda. So my last point is strengthening cooperation on Belt and Road Initiative and implementation of 2030, a common cause for China and countries along the Silk Road. China has incorporated the Belt and Road Initiative and 2030 agenda into its 13th five-year plan for national economic and social development. As China pursues its innovation-driven, coordinated, green, open, and shared development, we will work even more closely with all countries along the routes to strengthen bilateral and multilateral cooperation mechanisms for the Belt and Road initiatives. We will energize the development of international economic corridors in the region and promote infrastructure connectivity with neighboring countries. We will foster an open and inclusive people-to-people exchange by strengthening cooperations in all areas, including education, science, technology, tourism, environment and health, etc. So together, China and countries along the Belt and Road will open up a new prospects for cooperation and build a community of shared future featuring political mutual trust, economic integration, and cultural diversity. And every outcome we achieve in the Belt and Road Initiative will constitute our joint contribution to the global implementation of 2030 Agenda. In closing, I wish this symposium a success and look forward to great ideas and suggestions for implementing the Road and Belt Initiative and 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. I thank you.
Her Excellency, Ms. Liu, thank you for your inspirational words. And now I'd like to take the moment to introduce the awards ceremony. We, as the International Turkic Academy, are presenting this gold medal award to Professor Aziz Sancar in recognition of not only his outstanding contribution to science, but also for his efforts to promote a sense of pride of the Turkic peoples worldwide. Professor Aziz Sancar has been awarded outstanding awards for his accomplishments, including the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2015. He once wrote these following words. There are three characteristics essential for a successful scientist: creativity based upon knowledge, hard work, and perseverance in the face of failure. By highlighting the role of education system after Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, Professor Sancar also told us that an excellent education instilled in me the pride of Turkish people and my country's history, a sense of confidence that we could continue to accomplish great things. Such self-assessments of Professor Sancar are a reflection of the renaissance of the Turkic culture. His studies on the DNA repair is a big contribution to humanity. These discoveries have increased our understanding of how the living cell works, the causes of cancer, and the aging processes. It is a universal achievement of the humankind, and we are honored to have him among us today. I'd like to invite Professor Sancar to podium, and also Professor Darkan Kıdrali, president of TÜVESKO, to give his award. Before we give them a round of applause to all of them, I will also ask our guests to go to their respective tables, please. But can you please join me in welcoming our Nobel laureate, renowned Professor Aziz Sancar. Professor, please, for a speech, please.
Thank you very much. I wasn't asked, or I didn't know I was supposed to make some remarks, but I will. I'm truly honored to represent not just Turkey, the entire Turkic world, for being the first person from the Turkic world to get a Nobel Prize in science. We have made great contribution to science throughout our history, but for a variety of reasons, for the last two, three centuries, the Turkic world has not played its important role in scientific progress. And I believe it is our duty, not just to the Turkic world, but to the entire humanity, that we emphasize education, science, math, to progress of all humankind. And I'm really honored to receive this award from the Turkic world, and I'll do my best to promote both the Turkic world's integration as well as science and education in the Turkic world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sanjar. It's an honor. Our next honoree is Professor Kemal Karpat. After being appointed to the United Nations Economic and Social Council, he had worked as a lecturer and administrator in a number of educational institutions, including the Montana State University, New York University, Princeton, Harvard University, Johns Hopkins University, and Columbia University. After acting as the founding chairman of the Central Asian Studies Society, Professor served as the coordinator of the Central Asian Studies Program at the University of Wisconsin. As an American historian of Turkish origin, he contributed to the promotion of mutual understanding between the West and the East through his careful and systematic deliberations and unique perspectives. Please join me in welcoming Professor Kemal Karpat and Brooklyn Borough President Mr. Eric Adams, once more to the podium to give his medal. Professor, if we don't make you tired, can you give us a 5-minute speech, please? I'll hold it, please. None.
Distinguished guests, it is a special honor and at the same time a pleasure for me to receive this high honor from a new institution which is opening new roads towards the collaboration of continents, religions, and nations. The International Turkic Academy. By this effort, the Academy is re-knitting, re-tying ancient relations which existed between the West and East, and notably Central Asia. Many of you know that much of the Hellenic heritage, which is the basis of today's Europe or the West in general, the foundation, the Hellenic foundations, were preserved in Central Asia by local dignitaries, leaders, scholars. Al-Farabi, from the town of Farab in today's Kazakhstan. It is thanks to Al-Farabi that we know the writings of Aristotle, because he summarized the six volumes of Aristotle's writings, and they were passed on to the West. I could mention Ibn Sina or Avicenna, whichever way you want to call him, born in Bukhara. He was a medical scholar. His medical treatises were used in European universities as textbooks until the 17th century. I could mention Al-Biruni, who calculated the circumference of the globe. And 300 years before the discovery of America, pointed out that there should be a continent between Europe and Asia. This was the contribution of Central Asia, of the Muslims, to the West. And it worked the other way around. Ibn Rushd, known as Averroes, born in Cordoba, Spain. He was also a great scholar whose teachings, particularly his commentaries on Aristotle, influenced the development of science in the West. And Ibn Rushd was also a friend, teacher of Maimonides, the great Jewish scholars who renewed the faith in him. I could go on and on by giving you these examples that the East Central Asia, the Asian people, communicated with the West and contributed to the rise of Western civilization. All I wish is to have free access to all the sciences of the West today, so that scholars from Central Asia, from Asia, and Muslim world in general could bring back to their countries the very essence of the cultures that they help bring to the West. Indeed, this could happen only and only through the rejuvenation, revival of the Silk Road, and I'm indeed very happy to see that this beginning is made here at the United Nations and led by a new vibrant university, the International Turkic Academy in Astana. Thank you very much, and excuse, I went too long for my
talk. No, not at all. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Carpet. It was an honor. Our next honoree is Professor Edward Allworth. Professor Edward Allworth is an American historian who has served as professor of Turco-Soviet and Central Asian Studies at the Department of Middle Eastern and Asian Languages and Cultures Department of Columbia University. The son of Edward and Ethel, he was born on December 1, 1920. During World War II, he served as a platoon leader, second lieutenant in the 501st Parachute Infantry Regiment of the 101st Airborne Division of the U.S. Army. He served valiantly in active duty in the Normandy invasion and the division's battles thereafter through the Allied World War II victory in Northern Europe. Allworth was the director of the program on Soviet nationality problems at the School of International Affairs beginning in 1970, head of the Center for the Study of Central Asia, and general editor of the Duke University's Central Asia book series beginning in 1983. After teaching 33 years at Columbia University, he retired as emeritus professor in 1993. I'd like to invite Professor Edward Allworth, emeritus professor at Columbia University. He will be presented an award by Professor Osman Akın İbrahimov, former Secretary of State, Kyrgyz Republic, and professor of Manas University. Please welcome both to the podium.
Thank you, my dear.
Of course.
I don't deserve this.
Oh, here. For a picture.
Biraz,
If I deserve this high honor, it's because I feel that my product in my efforts is mainly the production of many good students. I don't have any other product than that. I feel like the many good students that came out of our efforts at the university was well worth it, and I hope that I can look forward to seeing them again and again. I see some of them sitting here now. Thank you for this honor.
Thank you, Professor Allworth. Our first panel is about to start. May I please invite the panel participants? And for this, I'd like to kindly ask also the professors to have their seats. So the first panel is about enhancing global peace and security on the Silk Road and beyond to combat transnational crime and extremism. Our moderator for this panel is His Excellency Mr. Halil Akıncı, former ambassador and chairman of the Council for Strategy and Policy of Hazar Strategy Institute, HASEN. Our speakers are, and I would like to welcome them one by one if they could come to the podium, Professor Adil Akmetov, member, Elders Council of Turkic Council, former personal representative of the OSCE Chairperson Office on Combating Intolerance and Discrimination Against Muslims. He's also professor of TUESCO. Admiral Metin Araç, member of the Council for Strategy and Policy of Hazar Strategy Institute, Hasan, His Excellency Mr. Serdar Gündoğan, Deputy Chairperson of Presidency for Turks Abroad and Related Communities, Republic of Turkey, Her Excellency Madame Günay Efendieva, President of the Turkic Culture and Heritage Foundation, Professor Norman A. Graham, Director of Center for European, Russian, and Eurasian Studies from Michigan State University, and Professor Uli Shamiloğlu, University of Wisconsin-Madison. Please welcome to the podium. Oh, okay. One correction. You don't have to come to the podium. Time saved. So you can, yes, you can be seated.
Panel. First of all, some administrative remarks. We are about half an hour behind. As Professor Sanjar mentioned, in science we are 200 years behind, so half an hour is not that much. But still, I have to curb the addresses of the participants. I have to limit them for 5 minutes. I know that all of them are, I know all of them personally, maybe except one. So I think they are talented enough to express their thoughts in 5 minutes. I believe in their intelligence and in their knowledge. Of course, as the moderator, I am setting no limits for myself. So about the Silk Road, interconnects different regions, Eurasia, and the rest of the world. I will just not, I'm not going to repeat what the speakers before me have addressed to, but I will only mention a few facts, the characteristics of the Silk Road. There were two main arteries, east-west, west-east, but also it is usually neglected to mention the other arteries, north-south, south-north. For example, yesterday, as we were discussing this with an Indian professor of, who is in our group, Professor Das, for example, there was an important secondary artery to India from the Silk Road. The key to the trade exchanges, commercial exchanges on the Silk Road was complementarity. Complementarity. This complementarity continued until the 16th, 17th century, passing through the, being conducted through the Silk Road. Later, there were different routes, but it was not just the, it was not just the commercial goods that traveled through the Silk Road, also ideas traveled. This was mentioned by Professor Carpet. The ideas, for example, I'll give you two, one example, which you'll find interesting. The number zero traveled from the Silk Road. Just try to write 999,000 in Roman numerals. If we didn't have zero, how could we have written this? There wouldn't be enough space in this room if you want to write it in Roman numerals. And secondly, now I am told that by my grandchild, who knows computers better than I do, that the key to today's information technology is binary numbers. It is zero and one. If we didn't have zero, we wouldn't have binary numbers. Chess again traveled along the Silk Road. Now, security was always the main concern in the countries to the left and to the right of the Silk Road, to destination as well as to the origin. And it was only, security was only provided by joint efforts of all the countries concerned. Despite the wars between and among themselves, they tried to preserve this route intact and functioning all the time. There were certain occasions where there were trade wars as well, in addition to the hot wars, but still they tried to keep this road intact. Now today, this road is under the threat of particularly terrorism. And when we mention terrorism, we have to add crime. They are twins. Crime feeds terrorism. Fighting for against terrorism, fighting for the security of all the peoples, not only along the Silk Road, but in the whole world, requires wholehearted cooperation of all the members. These are non-state actors. We have to cooperate and collaborate with each other in order to fight them. You should never say, as many nations have done this mistake before, you should never say, my terrorist is benign, because your benign terrorist of yesterday comes and blows your buildings here. So this fighting has to be in collaboration with all the actors. One final characteristic of the Silk Road is about the terms of trade. The Silk Road functioned because there were fair terms of trade. Both sides were profitable, the buyer and the seller, but the terms of trade were fair. Now I will give the floor to our first speaker, His Excellency Ambassador and Professor Adil Ahmetov. Melike Hanım already introduced him, so the floor is yours. And unfortunately, my fellow Aksakal, you have only 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. My speech is dedicated to Kazakhstan's role in the world peacekeeping and security. Your Excellencies, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, from the outset I would like to express my gratitude to the President of UN, ECOSOC, for the support to the initiative of the International Turkic Academy to host this high-level symposium in the headquarters of the UN. As the ninth largest country in the world, with a rich and a diverse history, modern Kazakhstan in 2.5 decades of independence and sovereignty has proven its diplomatic capabilities to address and solve some of the most difficult issues on the global peace and security agenda. As a regional leader and global partner in matters of energy and food security, and a valuable contributor to international peacekeeping missions, my country has accumulated valuable experience and expertise in tackling with the pressing challenges currently facing the world community. Home to over 130 nationalities and ethnic groups, my country itself is a microcosm of the United Nations, and today it has become a committed and principled partner in the family of nations. At this point, I would like to underline that today, the Assembly of the People of Kazakhstan and the Congress of Leaders of World and Traditional Religions, initiated by President Nazarbayev, serve as a unique model of interethnic harmony, stability, and interreligious peace and sustainable development. As a member of the Commission on Human Rights under the President of Kazakhstan, I am convinced that the main factor of peace and security in the modern reality is the assertion of common values that can unite peoples of different ethnic and religious background. In this context, I would like to refer to late John Paul II, who in his works invited the mankind not to be surprised at the differences that exist between cultures, religions, and civilizations. On the contrary, the late Pope advised the humanity to be surprised at the common values that unite all. Ladies and gentlemen, Today, it is also appropriate to underline that Kazakhstan had been at the vanguard of nuclear disarmament, and here it is worth to remind of President Nursultan Nazarbayev's historic decision to shut down the second largest nuclear test site in the world and give up voluntarily the world's fourth largest nuclear arsenal. Along with other countries in the region, Kazakhstan has established Central Asia as a nuclear weapon-free zone, which entered into force in March 2009. Kazakhstan has also initiated the development of a Central Asian action plan to strengthen nuclear security, prevention of nuclear proliferation, and nuclear terrorism. Besides the long-term goals and strategic priorities of Kazakhstan, adhere to a balanced and consistent multilateral foreign policy aimed at further strengthening relations with the UN and other international organizations. Within this context, it is worth to mention that the country had successfully chaired a number of key multilateral organizations, the OSCE in 2010, Ministerial Conference of the Organization for Islamic Cooperation in 2011, resulting in creation of the organization's Institute for Food Security and Commission on Human Rights, the Conference on Interaction and Confidence Building in Asia in 2010 and 11. Kazakhstan is also active in the Cooperation Council of Turkic-speaking countries. To this end, I would say it is the right time and the right place to outline a few more details related to the contribution of Kazakhstan to global peace and security, human rights, rule of law, and sustainable development. Today's Kazakhstan is a stable, progressive, and peaceful middle-income country with one of the world's fastest-growing economies, achieving Millennium Development Goals and international standards. The country is one of the key players in the Eurasian security community with its proactive stance in mediation and confidence building in Asia. On the other hand, being the world's largest landlocked developing country, Kazakhstan today is also playing an active role in the realization and the implementation of the new International Silk Road project. This powerful international transport corridor, passing through five vast regions of the country, is not only earning revenues to the budget of the Republic, but it is also strengthening peace and economic security within the whole Eurasian space. Ladies and gentlemen, alongside with this, Kazakhstan adheres to the position that the use of force to promote peace must remain a last resort, in accordance with the provisions of the UN Charter. And hence, Kazakhstan is a strong supporter of UN peacekeeping operations and maintains a clear position that these operations have to be carried out only in accordance with the UN Security Council resolutions and in strict compliance with the international law. And as I am short of time, concluding my speech, I would like to say a few words about the International Turkic Academy. As it has been already mentioned, this is a new academy, and though the headquarters of this academy is located in Astana, this academy belongs to all the Turkic states, to Kazakhstan, to Turkey, to Kyrgyzstan, to Azerbaijan. And now it has established very close ties with all the research centers of the Turkic world. It has recently launched its website, and this site is visited by many people from all the world. The Academy has initiated the Union of Academy of Sciences of the Turkic States, and it has established very close ties with the research centers of the United States of America, China, and Hungary, and Mongolia, and very many other countries. It is with this I would like to finish my short report, because time is out. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, before I give the floor to Admiral Metin Ataç, Melike Hanım failed to mention he was the 22nd commander of the Turkish Navy or Navy Chief of Turkey. So I think he is the only sailor among us. So with his presence at the Hazard Strategy Institute, we have decided to put an end to the landlocked status of Central Asia. So I'll just add one sentence to the Turkic Academy. You know, the Turkic Council is a system comprising different institutions, and academy was inaugurated by President Nursultan Nazarbayev and former Turkish President Abdullah Gül in 2010 as a national Kazakh institution at the beginning, but later it became an international institution. The agreement has been signed. Although there are some problems for the completion of all the legal documents, I think it will be successfully completed in the coming years. But without waiting for the completion of all the formalities, Academy started functioning as a full-fledged scientific organization. Although it is owned by Turks, it is not close to others. All the scientists of merit are welcome to work with the Turkic Academy. This is the approach. Now, Admiral, again, I will repeat before giving you the floor. You have 5 minutes. Please proceed.
Thank you. Everybody? Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As being a humble naval officer here today, I'm very happy to be able to speak to you all. And at the same time, really, I'm honored to be with you. And I should say that I congratulate Turkic Academy for organizing such a very good and fruitful symposium. Okay, even if it's for 5 minutes, I'm very happy to speak. I was going to tell the importance of the Silk Road, both in history and today, but this has been covered with the previous speaker, so I will skip that. But I should mention that Silk Road goes 63% of the world land portion. It covers a huge area. Okay, today I will try to explain what threat to the Silk Road. I'm talking about transnational crimes and violent extremism. Some kind of two different things. According to the United Nations 1995 explanations, it's been categorized in 18 areas. Here I'm not going to talk about all the categories, but I should say that money laundering is at the top. And the other grouping, some kind of a provision of illicit goods, illicit services, infiltration of business and governments, and some kind of terrorist actions. Of course, drug trafficking, human body part trafficking and trade, and also racketeering, bribery, corruption, all these things comes first in this category. Now I go with the violent extremism. It is the belief of action of group who support violence. It can be ideological, religious, or political. And here, if we also say that all these groups seek to change people through fear and intimidation. And in the history, it happened. If we look at the 13th century, Hasan Sabbah, for example, with the poisoned dagger, his group poisoned dagger attacks and kill like a suicide attackers. And that was an example in the history. Hit and propagate. Hit and propagate. That was their main way of life. Of course, ideological violences like neo-Nazi groups or hate groups comes under this section, and also issue-based terrorism come under this category, anti-governmental, anti-capitalism, or anti-globalization is also grouped on this part. Again, another group is ethno-nationalist group, like ETA type of thing. When we, so I could say why this happens in our times. What is the reason? Of course, in this very short period of time, state weakness, globalization, improving the technological means, interconnectedness, permissive governments, and decline in security causes. So today, perhaps the most disturbing is that transnational criminal syndicates may actively seek out cooperative relationship with the new terrorist groups. Thus, they try alongside each other. Last words, what to do? Very brief. Coordination, cooperation among nations. Prioritize interagency cooperation on the highest level, highest level of the countries. Establish interagency cooperation at the lowest level between law enforcement and police systems. Fight a network with a network, and identify the level of collision and respond accordingly. Time's up, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Admiral. Thank you very much. I hope the nations keep your advice and cooperate. Well, our next speaker is Ms. Günay Efendiyeva, President of the Turkey Culture and Heritage Foundation, with headquarters in Baku. This is another new institution of the Turkic world, which aims at integration and cooperation among the Turkic states. Please, I won't repeat. You have 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you.
But I've already repeated.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The topic is multiculturalism. What is this problem or solution view from Azerbaijan? Excellencies, distinguished delegates, dear colleagues and friends, I am very pleased to participate in an event where important issues for modern society, such as dialogue between civilizations, multiculturalism, along with other very urgent issues related to the development of cooperation and friendship among nations, will be discussed. The Turkey Culture and Heritage Foundation comprises four Turkic-speaking countries, namely the Republic of Azerbaijan, the Republic of Kazakhstan, Kyrgyz Republic, and the Republic of Turkey. As president of this organization, I see its role in the promotion of knowledge of the cultures of Turkic peoples in the world. As it is known, Turkic peoples do not follow only one religion. Despite the fact that most of the Turks are Muslims, Yakuts follow Shamanism and Christianity, Chuvash and Gagauz Christianity, Karaims and Krimchaks follow the Jewish religion, the Tuva people follow Buddhism. Historically, the Turkic peoples have had their own lifestyles and life views. It is also a manifestation of this existence of the values of multiculturalism in the countries they reside. We have centuries-long common history, language, traditions, and cultural values. We have common heritage, which is reflected in historical epics Dede Gorgut and Manas. All these factors are part of the world. Figurantly, the Turkic nations are the branches of one and the same tree,
and together able to overcome any difficulty. Our mission is to preserve and transmit our common heritage to future generations. Next month, the 7th Global Forum of the UN Alliance of Civilizations will be held in Baku. This is not by chance. Azerbaijan has gained a unique and rich experience in multiculturalism that deserves to be shared. Multiculturalism is one of the directions of the state policy of Azerbaijan. The 2016 was declared the year of multiculturalism there. Nowadays, Azerbaijani model of multiculturalism has recently started to be studied in practice. However, it has always existed as a part and parcel of national values, customs and traditions of the Azerbaijani people, long before the term multiculturalism was coined. Our society did not import this phenomenon from the outside, but has adapted it from within. The passage of the historic Silk Road through the region had a positive impact on the traditions of multiculturalism. The caravanserais of that time, representatives of different religions and peoples, along with cultures, customs, and traditions of the indigenous peoples were shared. These factors encouraged the process of interaction of cultures. At the beginning of the last century, Azerbaijanis, as well as Russians, Armenians, Jews, and one German were represented in the parliament of the Azerbaijan Democratic Republic. There are a number of localities in Azerbaijan where different ethnic minorities live. Its famous village of the Jewish community, Red Quarter, a village of Molokans, Ivanovka, a village of Udins, Nich, the Hanalik village of Guba, and all of them are integral parts of the Azerbaijani society. At the same time, Russians, Ukrainians, Belarusians, Kurds, Jews, Greeks, Tatars, and Germans live in the republic. By decision of UNESCO, 200th anniversary of the resettlement of the Shvab Germans to Azerbaijan and Georgia will be celebrated by the organization in 2017. Despite the tragic consequences of the Armenian-Azerbaijan Nagorno-Karabakh conflict and the expulsion of all Azerbaijanis from Armenia, 30,000 Armenians continue to live now in Azerbaijan. As you can see, the various ethnic and religious minorities live in the country in peace and while preserving their cultural and religious traditions, they respect each other. At the same time, the rights and interests of minorities are promoted and protected by the national legislation. Many of them publish their own magazines and newspapers. The holidays and special occasions of the various religious communities in Azerbaijan are regularly celebrated along with the national holidays. The President of the Republic holds meetings with leaders of those communities. The Orthodox churches, Catholic cathedrals, synagogues, and mosques, that one of the unique features of Baku, are open for all. Another historical and cultural monument, the German Kirche, is one of the remarkable places of interest in Baku. Despite the conflict, the Armenian church will still stand in the center of the capital. This attitude comes from the tolerance for all religions as a cultural future. Today, we consider multiculturalism as one of key components of state policy that should be researched, taught, and advocated. The International Center for Multiculturalism, as a center of research and promotion of multicultural models, was established by President Mr. Ilham Aliyev. The subject Azerbaijani multiculturalism is taught in 11 foreign universities in the academic year 2015-2016. Also, 20 Azerbaijani universities have started to teach multiculturalism at bachelor and master degrees. I believe that such projects will be continued. Esteemed participants, the Turkic Culture and Heritage Foundation is one of the latest initiatives of Azerbaijan aimed at uniting countries and people. The foundation will cooperate with other Turkic-speaking and international organizations. We can surely benefit from any mutual cooperation. We will do our best to fulfill this mission and will be active in the protection and promotion of the history and culture of the Turkic-speaking peoples in the cause of establishing greater mutual awareness and harmony between peoples of different cultures, multiculturalism. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Efendiyeva. Now the floor is Mr. Serdar Gündoğan's Deputy Chairperson of Presidency for Turks Abroad and Related Communities, Republic of Turkey. Please.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, distinguished guests, first of all, I would like to thank International Turkic Academy for this symposium and for a special session called Global Peace and Security on the Silk Road and Beyond. As we all the world today have been experiencing terrorism and conflicts everywhere. In accordance with the panel, I participate as a speaker. I will give you a brief overview on Silk Road, its place in the world civilization, the common values and symbols, and lastly, I will talk about contribution of our administration for Turks abroad and related committees, shortly YTB, activities to regional global peace and cultural interaction. For the social scientists, road has very different meanings. For example, for an economist, road is an instrument for the delivery of goods produced. For a historian, road is a source for making study of past events. And for a sociologist, road is an important tool for easy transportation to social interaction. In brief, road is a civilization. In this context, Silk Road was not just a road where the goods such as silk and spice were transported. It is also sole transportation corridor between East and West, between Asia and Europe. The Silk Road is ground of sedentism and urbanization in the region. The development of trade on the road is also a result of the mobility along the Silk Road. The Silk Road provided great environment to mobility and development of science, art, and thought. This road has been a place of figures of knowledge, wisdom, and love and cultures from Al-Farabi to Ibn Sina, from Yusuf Hacip to Mahmud Kashgari, from Hoca Ahmet Yesevi to Mevlana, from Alişir Nevai to Mahdum Kulifrake. Distinguished guests, the world needs wisdom of Ahmet Yesevi, tolerance of Mevlana, and love and peace of Yunus Emre today than ever before. I believe that the world will take a new breath with revitalization of common values of those thinkers and scholars mentioned above. With this purpose and philosophy, YTB, in addition to our citizens who live abroad, carries out activities towards relative communities in particular in the road of the Silk Road and the world in general. Coinciding with following words of Yunus Emre, come, let us all be friends for once. YTB contributes communication and cultural mobility and building strong ties among communities and nations. YTB and other relevant institutions and bodies with the mission inherited from history and culture and paradigm shift that Turkey has been experiencing since 2000s has increased activities towards common cultural geography. As a result of this shift, YTB was established in 2010. Basically, we have three main working areas. One of them is Turkish diaspora. Briefly, we conduct works on Turkish citizens. Today, we have nearly 6 million people at 155 different countries all over the world. One of our main aims to promote and encourage participation in all aspects of life and protecting their own cultural assets. Second of our working area is what we call related communities, which is the main reason for being here today with you. As you may know, there are lots of Turkic-speaking or Turkey-related communities. This relation might have been in historical, cultural, or religious manners. In order to enhance relation with communities and nations with whom we have long historical and cultural ties, as a YTB, we have one-sided and joint projects supported by NGOs, universities, research centers, and public institutions and foundations. To give some examples, we support NGOs and sectoral capacity building programs, cultural exchange programs, cultural and historical heritage projects, publications in different languages and cultures, yacht summer schools in historical and cultural geography. Thirdly, our administration is some kind of an agent for higher education. As you may know, government scholarships were branded under the title of Turkey Scholarships. Our administration is carrying out all the process of Turkey scholarships. We supply our students flight tickets, accommodation, tuition fee, social security, and pocket money. We received 95,000 applications last year. We give 5,000 scholarships every year. Today, we have more than 16,000 international students in Turkey's scholarships program. To summarize, as an administration for Turks abroad and related communities, in three areas with mentioned instruments, we aim to develop the relation with communities and nations in the Balkans, Central Asia, Middle East, Far East Asia in particular, and in the other regions in general. And I hope that the activities we do as a whole makes contribution to peace and stability along the Silk Road and the world. Thanks for your patience. Deepest respects for everyone.
Thank you, Professor Gündoğan. Now the floor is Professor Norman A. Grams. Please, Professor.
Thank you. In late April 2015, I had the good fortune to participate as a panelist at the third Global Baku Forum on Building Trust in the Emerging New World Order, sponsored by the Azerbaijani government through the Nizami Ganjavi International Center. The opening address by President Ilham Aliyev stressed Azerbaijan as the place where civilizations met historically, serving essentially as a cultural and political bridge for the West and the Muslim world. He then went on to describe the remarkable years of Azerbaijan's transformation, blessed with substantial fossil energy resources and supportive neighbors, including Turkey and Kazakhstan. He stressed the importance of efforts to improve education, industrial diversification, but also described the delicate position in which his country finds itself. Some of this relates to the need to continue supplying energy to European markets without alienating other neighbors, noting the progress made on the Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan pipeline, the South Caucasian pipeline, and the Trans-Anatolian pipeline. He expressed some satisfaction and long-term optimism. National security cannot now be separated from energy security, in his view. The president stressed the dilemmas entailed with the need to rely on international law and ineffectual global security institutions at a time when respect for both is at an unprecedented low point. Reforms should not stop, in his view, and there are important advantages that flow from freedom. Much of the rest of the forum focused on the crisis in Ukraine, featuring three of the four previous presidents of Ukraine. But the final major focus of the forum was on the need to respond to radicalized religious and ethnic movements and the attendant challenges to Europe and Eurasia, including the abuse of subject populations and the resulting push of mass migration. One key element of security and prosperity along the Silk Road is the economic integration that has begun to grow beyond the pipeline tethering to a common energy source for Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey on the one hand, and Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and China on the other. This is separate from existing and prospective integration with the European Union, or in the case of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, and Turkmenistan, the Eurasian Economic Union, designed by Russia, and may be more intense than either existing institution. The Baku-Tbilisi-Kars Railway is a recent example of practical integration, keeping in mind that Turkey and Azerbaijan are Georgia's top two trading partners. This raises a series of larger questions about the prospects for economic development and true broad-based prosperity in post-communist Eurasia, as well as in Turkey. The key here, not surprisingly, may well be the proper role for the state to play in the economy, particularly in a region commonly identified as characterized by fragile democratization. One of the key strengths of the government in Turkey in recent years has been a successful program of economic liberalization, begun in part to support possible full membership in the European Union. This raises the question of the prospect for resolving the complex and resulting migration pressure so evident in Syria, Iraq, Turkey, and Northern Africa. Turkey is in many respects a key to this challenge, serving as both an initial safe haven for large numbers of refugees as well as a transit point for traffic to Greece and southeastern Europe, and from Europe to Syria for ISIL, ISIS volunteers. Washington and some important capitals in Europe still see Turkey as the bridge between the Christian West and the Muslim world. Stresses on this relationship abound as fears of the success of other groups continue on the ground, and the press of refugees from the conflict centers increase daily.
this bridge may indeed lead to nowhere the West really wants to go, except to the extent that connections to Azerbaijan and Central Eurasia remain important. What then determines the prospects here? The energy and broader trade network that has emerged between Europe and Central Eurasia, with Turkey and Azerbaijan as its heart, is a clear source of economic benefit for all concerned. It also continues to support the prospect for national political independence. But the true test of sustainable and broad economic prosperity must extend beyond the production and marketing of fossil fuels. This takes us to the question of how to extend economic development beyond the carbon fuel sector. Indeed, how to avoid the oil natural resource curse. There is no space here for a full examination of this question, but a few comments on how this relates to the future of Turkey, Azerbaijan, and Kazakhstan, potentially, and their relationship with the broader region and indeed the world economy seem in order. First, how sustainable are the Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan political economies as now configured? This obviously raises immediate questions of the size of oil and gas reserves, the volatility of oil pricing, and the security of transportation networks. With these potential constraints in mind, the incentive to look for economic development and prosperity from other sectors is high. Azerbaijan and Kazakhstan have marshaled resources from previous energy exports for investments to this end. A preliminary review of these investments indicates considerable infrastructure development, improvements in K-12 and higher education institutions, ancillary enterprise development in the energy sector, but little exemplary economic development in non-energy sectors. There's a high level of public and private commitment to diversify the industrial and commercial bases in these countries. But like many oil and gas-rich countries, the result is modest at best. Certainly, there is no evidence of an economic takeoff in manufacturing, high technology, innovation, and commercialization. There's some progress in agricultural productivity in recent years, but again, there's much left to be done. What explains this? The first part of the answer to this challenging question is that there is something critical missing in many Eurasian states that have not liberalized economically and politically. As Linda Weiss reminded us in The Myth of the Powerless State, state-led industrialization can work under certain circumstances, for example, in Germany, Japan, and Korea. But more often than not, it seems that the states make poor investment decisions and waste resources on industrial commercial dead ends. There are some good examples of investments made by states. Russia did make some investments aimed directly at enhancing its participation in high technology industries. For example, there was the plan for a miracle innovation city, Moscow's Silicon Valley. In February 2012, Vladislav Surkov announced the plan to build an innovative city concentrating 30,000 to 40,000. I'll wrap up. I'm almost done. 40,000 of the brightest, most talented people from all corners of the world. This would generate, in his view, $7 billion of annual income. I think this is yet to be resolved. Lauren Graham, perhaps the foremost Western authority on Russian and Soviet science and technology successes and failures, put his finger on the nub of the problem facing many states that don't have perfect freedom. In his book, Lonely Ideas, he reports on the partnership of his university, MIT, with Russia to establish the Skolkalov Institute of Science and Technology. As of yet, this hasn't worked very well. I would just like to contrast this effort with what's actually happened in Turkey in recent years, with the major success of modern Turkish universities like Middle East Technical University, Istanbul Technical University, Gazi University, Istanbul University, Koç University, Savanchi, etc. Many of these have developed high-quality science and ABET-accredited engineering degree programs, some of which have collaborated with U.S. universities and associated technoparks, which have led to some dramatic industrial improvement. I'll stop there just to say that this is an interesting example that I think can be something carried through the Turkic world and something perhaps the Academy can look into in helping to stimulate. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Now our last speaker is Ms. Professor Uli Şamiloğlu. Please, Professor, floor is yours.
Excellencies, dignitaries, honorees, and colleagues, my name is actually Uli Şamiloğlu. On the occasion of this event, honoring the 25th anniversary of the independence of the five Turkic-speaking republics of Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and Kazakhstan, I would like to offer a few brief reflections on the Turkic state traditions shared by these five republics and by the Republic of Turkey. The majority of the populations of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkey, Turkmenistan, and Uzbekistan speak closely related languages which belong to what we call the Turkic family of languages. Each of these peoples traces its history back to the earliest Turk Empire established in Mongolia in 552. Their shared recorded historical memory goes back to the Orhan inscriptions, the oldest recorded monuments in the Turk language or Turkic language, describing the deeds of the Turk rulers of the early 8th century. The Turk Empire was led by a dynastic line known as the Arshilash, meaning the noble kings. The head of state of the Turk Empire was known as the Kagan, a term which was also used by the heads of other great states of Eurasia in this period. At the same time, it appears there were different kinds of divisions within the state as well. The sources indicate that there were five tribal confederations or tribes, each within the eastern and western halves of the first Turk Empire. Thus, the earliest Turkic state was led by a dynastic ruler in alliance with some kind of sub-state formations representing the broader population. This was also true of the succeeding empire of the Tokuz Oghuz, the Uyghur Khaganate, which was one of the tribes, the Uyghurs were one of the tribes of the Tokuz Oghuz, or the Nine Oghuz of the 8th century. In the late 10th century, we see the emergence of the Seljuk state, which represents a new Oghuz Turkic Persian tradition, breaking away from the traditional Inner-Asian model of the state. While there were tribes in the Seljuk state, it does not appear that their role was as significant as in the Inner-Asian tradition. By accepting Islam, the Seljuks were embracing the Islamic concept of the ruler or sultan, and Islam served as a new source of legitimacy. From this tradition, we see the emergence of what has been termed more recently as the southern tradition of Turkic state tradition. The dynasty of the Ottoman Empire also emerges from this southern tradition. A second tradition emerges in the 12th, 13th century in the figure of Temujin, later proclaimed as Chinggis Khan. In the early 13th century, his empire emerged to establish states in Central Asia, the Eurasian steppe region, the Chagatai Khanate, and the Golden Horde, and finally China, too. Even though Chinggis Khan was a Mongol, his successors established, so the Chagatai Khanate in Central Asia and the Golden Horde in Western Eurasia, rapidly Turkified. By the time of the collapse of the Mongol world empire in the mid-14th century, we must speak of these states as representing a new northern Turkic tradition of statecraft. In each of these states, the tradition the power of the ruler, Orhan, was severely limited by the four leading tribes representing the land in each of these states, or the population. The collective group of the leaders of the four leading tribes selected the Khan, removed incompetent Khans, commanded the army, and conducted the foreign relations of the state. No decree of the Khan was legal without their approval. While this system was characteristic of the states of the later Golden Hordes of the 15th, 18th centuries, so the Khanates of Crimea, Kazan, Kasimov, and other states, it also existed in the 13th and 14th centuries. In other words, the Khan was not an all-powerful sovereign. Rather, his powers were limited by the tribes or people. The early 20th century saw the Young Turk Revolution and the Bolshevik Revolution. With the establishment of the Republic of Turkey and the USSR, we see the establishment of new state formations in Anatolia, the South Caucasus, and Central Asia, and elsewhere, of course. These were modern states with a secular leadership, a revolutionary ethos, and modern political institutions. In the Republic of Turkey, this was a state with law codes drawn from Europe. In the case of republics in the USSR, they were based upon the preeminence of the Communist Party of the USSR and official atheism. Each of the Turkic-speaking states continues the tradition of a strong ruler. Yet we see that the history of the Turkic peoples also has a role for segments of the population outside of the ruling dynasty. In traditional societies, this was the system of tribes found within each state, and of course that's not completely disappeared. In the 20th century, this is represented by the parliaments in each of these states. In the Golden Horde and its successor states, the tribes representing what we call the land could remove a sitting Han and choose a new Han. Do the parliaments in the Turkic states of the 21st century have a similar power? In conclusion, it is true that historically the Turkic states have a tradition of a strong ruler, but it is also true that the power of the ruler was limited by the authority of the tribes. In the 21st century, we can look to the authorities invested in the parliaments and the courts as a continuation of the authority previously invested in the tribes. I wish the newly independent Turkic-speaking states of Central Asia a long and successful trajectory. I wish all of the Turkic-speaking republics great success in balancing the power of the Kagan, Sultan, Khan, or President with the power of the citizen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Shamiroğlu. I just would like to add 2 points to the information that you have kindly provided us about the Turkic history. The first state called by the name of Turkey or the land of the Turks was Egypt. Why was that? Because the Turkic, mainly of Kipchak origin, the slave soldiers who were brought to Egypt, they just overthrew the Ayyubid Sultan and they established themselves. And the first king or the first Kagan or the first emir was called Aybek, which means slave soldier. After a few years after that, another another let's say change of power occurred in India. Another Aybek founded the Delhi Turkish Sultanate. Delhi Turkish Sultanate. Again, he was a slave soldier of Muizzeddin, an Afghan emir, but later he founded the Turkic state. So while thanking Professor Shamiroğlu for the valuable information he has given, I just ventured to add a few points to that. Now the first panel has come to a conclusion. We have just surpassed the time allotted to us by 15 minutes. So I leave the floor to the chairman of the second panel, Professor Quint. And after that, I think we will have lunch, a reception. But before giving the floor to Professor Quint, I would like to thank, first of all, the chairman of the president of the Academy, Professor Darhan Hıdırali, for organizing this, and the partners, among which we have my own institute, Hazar Strategy Institute. So I again thank all the participants, all the speakers of our panel, and again thank the organizers for organizing this meaningful event. And I think tonight Türksoy will invite us to a concert of the Turkic world, and we will be rewarded for all the efforts that we have spent by discussing things in the panels. Thank you very much all.
Thank you, His Excellency, Mr. Haylakınca. I hope not to make the mistake of the titles in the second panel. And you made almost all the announcements, but I would like to add one thing. In observance of the International Day of Nevruz, the International Organization of Turkic Culture is organizing a concert tonight at 7 p.m. in the General Assembly Hall. It's organized by Turksay, I repeat. So you're all welcome. Our second panel is about to start, and it is about reaching sustainable development goals through enhancing the Silk Road through bridging cultures. Our moderator is Professor Dr. Vladimir Quint. It's good to see you here, Professor, with us. He is the President of International Academy of Emerging Markets. And our speakers are Mr. Abzal Sapar Bekuli, the Deputy Secretary General of Turkey Council, His Excellency Mr. Duysen Kasenov, Secretary General of Turksoy, Professor Osman Akun Ibramov, former Secretary of State, Kyrgyz Republic, Professor of also Manas University, Professor Ram Upendra Das, expert at Research and Information System for Developing Countries, Professor Dr. Timur Kocaoğlu from Michigan State University, and Mr. Haldun Yavaş from Hazan. He's the Secretary General of Hazar Strategy Institute. And I would like to welcome all of you to start the panel. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Meliki, very much. It's a pleasure to see you here. Meliki is well known, as you know, on Bloomberg. I had an honor to give interview to Meliki back in October, when my last book was published, this one, Strategy on the Global Market. It's a pleasure for me. And Meliki, you did a lot of job for me because you introduced already members of our panel. Later, I will say a few words about their specialties. But what I would like to tell you, I am very happy that on this event, we are not speaking only about political issues and cultural issues, also about economics. As an economist and strategist, for me it's especially great pleasure to speak in front of such a distinguished audience at the Economic and Social Council of the United Nations. What can I tell you? Silk Road is a long issue, even when this term didn't exist, because term is pretty novelty back from 19th century. But Silk Road by different vectors was developed throughout the history when two major, I would say by modern language, global players, Europe and China, try to cooperate with each other, to develop trade with each other. Since increasing role of China in international economics, in business, and of course in politics, Silk Road again became a major issue on international agenda. With increasing role of China and its input to global GDP, to world GDP, China started to experiencing, as well as European players, started to experience a lot of losses for inefficient transportation connections. Traditional Silk Road was actually, in 20th and 21st century, was through ocean and sea, which takes roughly 45 days if we will take from Shanghai or Hong Kong. We stop in India, stop in Africa, and then ending in somewhere in Europe, typically in Venice. It takes 45 days. In 20th century, and especially during the first years of 21st century, discussion about vectors of development of Silk Road markedly increased. There are several ways now which on the agenda. Typical way is mostly going through territory of Kazakhstan, and it's obvious that it's interesting for Kazakhi leadership especially because 40% of Kazakhstan foreign trade now with European Union, 40%. But Kazakh territory required a lot of development for increase capacity to transit a lot of goods and services through Silk Road on Kazakh territory, going then to Europe by several vectors as well. It can be going through Azerbaijan, Georgia, Turkey, or a little bit to the north through Ukraine and Russia, of course. But major seaport of Turkey, Aktau, required to be substantially improved. At the moment, they can turn over roughly 13 million tons of goods through Aktau seaport on Caspian Sea. It's required to increase capacity of this seaport at least by 25 million tons by year 2020, roughly. Georgia is making one step ahead of Kazakhstan. Georgia already substantially increased its seaport capacity, and it's already increasing cooperation through Silk Road by several vectors, through Ukraine, Azerbaijan, Turkey, and Kazakhstan territory to China. But this vector of Silk Road, however, have some limits. First of all, it's required use of two ferries and two loads of goods on Caspian Sea and Black Sea. Another way is, of course, and major way is, one of the major way is Turkey itself. Turkey at the moment substantially increasing its trade with China. As far as I know, at the moment, Turkey decreased its foreign trade deficit in China during 2 months of 2016 by 15%. Nonetheless, Turkish leadership still improved situation, but not improved to the substantial level, because Turkish export to China still covering only 74% of Turkish import from China. So it's a long way to go. But nonetheless, Turkish government encouraging China to invest to Silk Road, as well as encouraging domestic investors. It's very important for Turkish situation. By the way, by the end of 2015, China became number one foreign trade partner of Turkey, with the mutual foreign trade balance is about $25 billion. Of course, we cannot forget about Russia, because Russia also given a lot of attention to Silk Road, mostly through two railroad systems. One is Trans-Siberian Railroad, and another one roughly 800 kilometers to the north, Baikal-Amur Railroad. Russia also needs tremendous investment in order to be ready to increase cooperation between Europe and China, and charging for transit. Also negative tendency in Russian-Chinese trade, because during last year, foreign trade between Russia and China declined by 28% to the $64.5 billion. It's a huge decline. And it seems, to my analysis, this year situation will deteriorate again. China is very interesting to invest and improve Silk Road by all of vectors which I mentioned, through all territories. This is why China established Silk Road Fund with $40 billion for loans and investment. It's not good enough. It's good, but not good enough, because my calculation showed that it's roughly required seriously improve capacity of Silk Road about $800 billion, not 40. With this investment, it will influence input of countries along Silk Road and Silk Road itself in global GDP roughly to the by 0.5, maybe even 1% of global GDP, and increase standard of living roughly 2/3 of global population. So Silk Road is a humongous project with just at initial stages of development. With these words, I will finish in what I try to say. And of course, as all members of our panels, at the end of this session, we will be happy to answer for questions. And now I would like to introduce members, to give floor to members of our panel. First of all, Abzal Saparbekuli. He is Deputy Secretary General of Turkic Council, and he will speak about integration of Turkic world, mostly focusing on tourism, transportation, but not only. You're welcome.
Thank you, Chairman.
You're welcome.
Dear President of International Turkic Academy, esteemed participants, it's an honor for me to address such a distinguished audience today on the occasion of the International Turkic Academy Symposium, and particularly at this session. On behalf of my Secretary General, Ambassador Amil Hasanov, I would like to congratulate President Mr. Khadrali for organizing this significant and timely event. Dear colleagues, as we all know, traditional Silk Road constitutes a remarkable destination in the history for trade and economic relations, with its capacity to be a staunch network for journey of people, exchange of cultures, and innovative ideas. This multidimensional function of the Silk Road turned into a unique and significant hub for interaction between the East and West, as well as North and South Eurasia. Almost five centuries passed after the Great Silk Road lost its charm. However, today, we witness multiple efforts for its revival. The reason behind these efforts is very simple. Silk Road presents an important transport corridor, not only transport, also trade and economic corridor, that will have a key role in the achievements of sustainable development goals in our and around region. As Cooperation Council of Turkic-speaking states, shortly Turkic Council established in 2009 in the format of intergovernmental organization, with our founding member states, namely Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Turkey, we act to contribute to the revival of the Silk Road through our projects and activities. According to research of the UN World Tourism Organization, when it is mentioned about the Silk Road, six Turkic-speaking states come to mind in the top 10 list. And this gives an extra responsibility to the Council that aims not only to cooperate among each other, but also across the region. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, in line with globalization, the trend of new regionalism has expanded into Eurasia. Turkic Council is located at the epicenter of this trend, with its comprehensive approach towards regional cooperation and regional ownership. Thus, the Council embraces political, economic, and cultural cooperation in its basket. Turkic Council is an umbrella institution which carries out and coordinates the cooperative initiatives among its member states. TurkSoy, Turkic Culture and Heritage Foundation, TurkPA, Turkic Business Council, as well as Nomadic Civilization Center, constitute the sister organizations within the cooperation. And of course, this collaboration is open to cooperate with the third parties on the basis of common interests. Turkic Council works on enhancing regional cooperation in several fields, from economy, transportation, customs affairs, tourism, to education and media. As an inclusive organization with its bid to become an observer to the UN General Assembly, Turkic Council is pleased to collaborate with regional and international actors in each on the field that it operates. For instance, we are observer to the Economic Cooperation Organization since 2012 and have inclusive dialogue with the OSCE, while we closely cooperate with UNDP, UN World Tourism Organization, United Nations Economic Commission Europe, and UN Office for South-South Cooperation. we also desire to launch a new cooperation process with UN Alliance of Civilization in the near future. The International Conference on Information and Communication Technologies for Development that we co-hosted with UNDP in October 2015 in Istanbul was a concrete step realized to this end. We are planning to continue our cooperation with UNDP for regional development in various areas to face new challenges and better meet people's needs. With the same spirit, we will sign soon an MOE with the UN Office for South-South Cooperation in Istanbul. Distinguished participants, as Turkey Council, we firmly believe that making national economies more resilient will play a significant role in regional empowerment. Therefore, diversification of economies, enforcement of connectivity, and development of transport corridors are high on the Turkey Council's agenda. In this connection, we consider the tourism sector, among others, as an important means for sustainable regional development. Through our single tourist road, modern Silk Road joint package, we work hard on turning the Silk Road into an attractive tourism destination. Just a few days ago, we visited the cities of Almaty, Turkestan, Chimkent, and Taraz with tour operators of our member states to make the field analysis. I can sincerely tell you that all participants were impressed by the rich cultural and historical heritage of Silk Road in the region. We designed our 12 days joint tour package, which will start this year, in the way to support rural development in and around our region. In our projects with regard to tourism sector, as in the case of other cooperation areas that we are involved in, we strongly believe that vocational trainings are fundamental for achievements of SDGs. The training on the service sector conducted by the Minister of Culture and Tourism of Turkey for tourism employees of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, and Kyrgyzstan transfer rich knowledge, know-how, and experience of Turkey in the tourism sector to the benefit of our other member states. Thus, in the last 2 years, almost 900 tourism employees benefited from these trainings. Dear participants, on the other hand, establishing a stable, integrated, and seamless transport along the Caspian Transport Corridor has been the primary motivation behind the efforts spent under the Turkey Council in transport field. According to statistics, the cargo transfer between Europe and Asia increased by 70-fold in the last 5 years. The trade growth between the Europe and China is expected to rise 10% each year. Turkic states, having a population of 140 million, spanning an area of 5 million square kilometers and with a GDP approximately $1.5 billion, constitute a significant part of this economic potential. Under these circumstances, we start to refer to a recalibrated version of the Silk Road, where Caspian Transport Corridor has a central role. And this role is related to its capacity to shorten the distance from Beijing to London. This potential that has been underestimated requires more attention and utilization. Let me give you a specific example. If this cargo is transferred by the Silk Road passing through Caspian Sea and then Baku-Tbilisi-Kars Railway to be finalized this year and Marmara Tunnel in Istanbul, it will only take 8,500 kilometers to reach Europe, compared to 23,000 kilometers by sea. This new transportation network utilizing the Caspian Sea connection that becomes operational cuts transport time to 10-12 days. On the other hand, to coordinate our efforts in the field of transport with the international community, we launch a cooperation with process with United Nations Economic Commission for Europe. Later, we co-hosted a group of expert meeting in October 2015 in Istanbul. Ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, as Turkey Council, we are confident that through enhancing the Silk Road in the sectors such as economy, transport, tourism, and of course education, we will get closer and closer to the achievement of sustainable development goals in our region and beyond. In this regard, the modern Silk Road will present a real hub for the development and innovation. With this understanding, we are glad to co-host today the official reception with the International Turkic Academy on the occasion of this high-level symposium. On behalf of my Secretary General and my own, I would like to thank once again President Mr. Khadrali for his efforts to prepare such a comprehensive high-level event in the UN headquarters for the first time. Afterwards, in the evening, we will enjoy together the concert of Turksoy dedicated to the 25th anniversary of the independence of the Turkic-speaking states that we celebrate this year. On this occasion, I would like to also congratulate Nevruz Festival of the Turkic people, which recently entered in the list of intangible cultural list of UNESCO. I would like to conclude that there is a huge potential of this unique road and for our common future. Therefore, as Turkic Council, with our affiliated organization, regional and international partners, we will continue our efforts to strengthen the Silk Road and render it a generator of sustainable development goals. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Sapar Bikuli. It's very interesting. Now I would like to give a floor to His Excellency Duysen Kaseynov. He is the Secretary General of Turksoy, International Cultural Organization of Turks, and he will be speaking mostly about cultural integration.
Thank you, Chairman. Excellencies, distinguished delegation members, I greet you with respect on behalf of Permanent Council of Ministers of Culture of Turkic-speaking countries. This year, we are celebrating the 25th anniversary of independence of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan with great enthusiasm. As you know, Turksoy was founded by the Minister of Culture of Turkic-speaking countries in Almaty in 1993. That means it has been carrying out its activities for 25 years as well. Located on the historical Silk Road, these countries have been considerable contributing to world peace and tolerance thanks to their rich cultural and historical heritage. Thus, as member countries of Turksoy, they also actively contribute to all activities is carried out on local level in Central Asia. As you know, Turksoy carries out activities to make it possible for artists, scholars, and intellectuals of the Turkic world to come together, strengthen their ties of friendship as well as their mutual cooperation. Indeed, Turksoy's activity in the field of culture and art offer them many valuable opportunities of mutual exchange. As an initiative launched by Turksoy in the recent past, the declaration of one city of the Turkic world as its cultural capital helped promote our cities and their historical and cultural heritage. At the same time, this initiative also plays an important role in creating new opportunities of cultural and artistic cooperation on a global scale. It is therefore a good example of cultural diplomacy. In 2012, the cultural capital of the Turkic world was Astana. This title was then borne by Eskişehir in 2013, followed by Kazan. In 2014, this prestigious title was then taken over the city of Merv. In the 2015, which transmitted it to Sheki, the beautiful historical city of Azerbaijan, for 2016. Thus, the cultural capital initiative of Turksoy literally followed the route of the Silk Road. With this initiative, Turksoy aims at the promotion of cultural capitals of the Turk world on the Silk Road, as well as at the further development of cultural ties among countries. Events and activities traditionally carried out by Turksoy every year are meant to contribute to the enrichment of culture and art of global scale. Within this framework, Turksoy has also held many events in cultural capitals of Europe in order to widen the scope of its cultural cooperation activities. An example thereof is the Chamber Choir of Turksoy, which took part in the second European Choirs Games and won 3 gold medals in the competition. The most important activity carried out by Turksoy is, of course, its Nevruz celebration. In the recent past, Nevruz celebration of Turksoy were held not only in the Turkic world, but also in many other countries of the world, such as the United States of America, France, Great Britain, Luxembourg, and Austria. Thus, Turksoy introduced this colorful tradition of the entire world as a common tradition of Silk Road countries. Artists, scholars, and intellects are key actors of cultural diplomacy. Therefore, as part of its commitment to the cultural integration of the Turkic world, Turksoy attached particular importance to the commemoration of these famous authors, artists, actors, musicians, and composers on the Turkic world who left indelible traces behind them, thus contributing to the enrichment of Turkic culture and art with their works. Hence, every year is dedicated to the commemorating of the famous personality of Turkic world by Turksoy. Within this framework, the year 2010 was dedicated to the commemoration of the Bashkort philosopher Zeki Veli Togan. This was followed by the Tatar poet Abdullah Tukay in 2011. The Azerbaijan playwright Mirza Fatali Akhundzadeh in 2012. The Kazakh composer Mukan Tuliyev in 2013. The Turkmen poet Maktumguli Peragi and Kyrgyz poet Toktogul Satılganov in 2014. And the Turkish author Haldun Taner, along with the Hakas, author of epic legends, Simeon Kadesh, in 2015. They have all been commemorated with various events throughout the Turkic world. This year, Turksoy member countries are celebrating the year of the Yusuf Hacı Hacip, the great philosopher of the Turkic world. Of course, there are also other activities carried every year by Turksoy to introduce the rich cultural and historical heritage of Silk Road countries to the world, such as opera days, press awards, meetings with UNESCO National Commissions, the Turk Vision Song Competition, gathering of painters, photographers, and sculptors, symposia of museum on the Turkic world, congresses of literature journals, and gathering of theater directors. Apart from this, Turksoy also provides support to Festival of Traditional Music regularly held in Turkish Republic. The Silk Road Festival organized in countries such as Azerbaijan and the United States of America is a good example thereof. Distinguished participants, it's impossible to sum up all activities carried out by Turksoy within the last 25 years of Turkic Republic independence in single text. But we can easily say that since its establishment, Turksoy's contribution and support to cultural artistic activities in candidate countries has been great. This in turn brings Silk Road countries and civilizations closer together. We would therefore like to extend my deepest gratitude to the Turk Academy for having organized this meeting, which is of great importance for world peace and alliance of civilization. I wish you success in all of the future activities. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you very much. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Osmanakun Ibrahimov, not only because he is a well-known statesman in Kyrgyz Republic, he is also professor, well-known professor of history and literature, including Russian literature, by the way. But for me, especially important, as a person who is studying strategy for 40 years, I am looking forward for this speech because Professor Ibrahimov will be speaking about strategy of Silk Road development. You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. Dear friends, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor and a pleasure to be here at the headquarters of the United Nations, in the very place where precisely 25 years ago, five Central Asian Soviet republics, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan, have been honored a historical recognition as a step independent nations. I clearly remember those unforgettable days, and it was maybe happiest moments of my life when the most brave and courageous dreams come true. 25 extremely important years have passed since the fateful 1991. Nowadays, we have seen totally different political landscape in the region than it was before the fall of the Soviet Union. Current developments in the region are qualitatively different. Five new nations of Central Asia have entered in a new paradigm of developments, having chosen different ways for establishing independent statehood and acquiring national identity. I would say that the very concept of sovereignty as well as nation-building process itself have been deeply evolved in the sense for these 25 years. A main point, which is equally sharing in the post-Soviet Central Asia, is seeking the optimal ways for sustainable development, looking forward strong guarantees for national security and territorial integrity. From this point of view, the reviving Great Silk Road, which we're talking about today, is an exciting idea for everybody, not only in Eurasia, but also over the world. So what does it mean, the reviving Silk Road, for us, for our region, for five stands, so to speak? It means, above all, a chance for breakthrough, for coming out from the Central Asian heartland to the intercontinental trade and the cultural roads. It means to be free from the geopolitical limitations which were historical in favor for some regional powers as well as regimes with new geopolitical ambitions. Dear friends, profoundly changed geopolitical landscape in Eurasia in the last decade have placed Central Asian independences in between two rising powers, Russia and the new economic giant China. Both of them striving for deepening their real influence on regional socio-economic developments. Say, Shanghai Cooperation Organization, Customs Union, Eurasian Union are immediate signs of this process. Closure of the USA airbase in Bishkek in 2014 has evidently created new situation, placing the region, as said British historian Pope, in the sense of joke between bear hug and the dragon's jaws. An intensified economic and political cooperation of Central Asia's new nations with these two powers, in spite of undoubted economic benefits, increase the risks of turning back notorious times of big brothers. From this point of view, the Great Silk Road still remaining is a unique chance for enhancing sustainable development for newly born independencies in the region, strengthening nation building process, not last but least for Central Asian republics. The next point I want to sound here would be a vital importance of the Silk Road to connect not only the north to the east, but also the south with the north to overcome existing geopolitical isolation. The railway connections between China and Russia via Great Steppes of Kazakhstan, as well as working out projects of railway connection from China to Uzbekistan via Kyrgyzstan, which already agreed on the highest level, and we are awaiting its practical implementation, is also an essential part of the reviving the Great Silk Road. Another direction of international railroad from China to Iran via Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, as well as a newly tested connection from Ukraine to China through Georgia and Azerbaijan, might be considered as the immediate signs of the reviving the Great Silk Road, which is not the virtual but real bridges enabled to bring together civilizations, nations, and have a vital importance for reaching strategic goals of new independent nations of Eurasia in the whole. Thus, all the post-Soviet nations ever, what does it mean, the revived Silk Road? Silk Road in our alarming times and for our vast subcontinent, which for centuries suffered due to lack of credible and the contemporary transport connections between most important geographical points of Eurasian hemisphere, Eastern Hemisphere, sorry. The Silk Road is and must be a road of cultural and humanitarian interconnections. It should be a road of peace and intensive economic cooperation. It means that a dream that so deeply excited 150 years ago, the great traveler and investigator of ancient cultures of Central Asia, Chokan Valikhanov, really comes true. Dear friends, new generations of Central Asia are now discovering and asserting the real scales and importance of remarkable civilization of ancient Turks now. We are very happy to know it. At the same time, I would like to remind the great French intellectual Paul Valéry, who said, "We civilizations now know that we are really mortal ones." This warning, which was addressed to all civilizations existing on the earth, could be directed with the greater relevance to all nations in our times of accelerating globalization and increased interdependence, because there is a real vital need of mutual contact, innovation, interaction, trade, exchange, and dialogue founded on equality of dignity and thus to guarantee sustainable social and economic development of all nations of Eurasia. Thank you for kind attention.
Thank you, Professor Ibrahimov. As you could see, many countries, not only we mentioning at the beginning China, European countries, especially Eastern European, Poland, Belarus, Ukraine, Georgia, Azerbaijan, and of course Turkey and Russia, interested in develop Silk Road. Kyrgyzstan is very interested to use its territory for charging transit. That's good. By the way, recently, roughly 2 weeks ago, China, together with Iran, started to test another Silk Road vector from seaport Wuhan in China directly to Tehran. It's decreasing time for delivery of goods by 30%, and it's without substantial investment. High technological investment in this sector can even further decrease time for delivery of goods. We have to see this project as a project which crossing interest and integrated interest through around the world. Even for the first glance, it looks like it's direct connection between Europe and China. And the best example of this is speech of next speaker, sorry, Professor Ram Upendra Das, because he will be speaking about role of India in sustainable development among Silk Road. By the way, at the moment, India having some income by charging for transit through their seaports when China is delivering goods to Europe and back European goods to China, stopping in the seaport of India. You're welcome, Professor.
Thank you, Chair. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, friends. Countries need to interact and cooperate, and the first step is friendship. And the end of cooperation also is friendship. And this is something very interesting because to become friends, you have to be friends. There is no other way to actually reach a destination which any cooperative endeavor between nations would help you to do that. Now, for that, let me begin from the beginning. The concept paper circulated at this symposium opens, and I quote, "The ancient Silk Road connects the old world all the way from China and India to Europe and Mediterranean Sea, forming a bridge between the East and the West. Being the epicenter of the Silk Road, the republics situated in Central Asia and the Caucasus look forward to building a prosperous future through sustainable economic development, political stability, and an environment of cultural tolerance and good neighborly relations. This aspiration continues till this day, even after a quarter century after the republics gained independence in the early 90s, and will continue into the future," I quote. This sums up the basic objective of this symposium, for which I must commend the efforts of all the organizers and partners at this very important historic venue. And I am indeed very glad to be a part of it. And this endeavor, India, has been historically an integral part, and it must be ready to play a dynamic role in future as well. And as you know, the United Nations Sustainable Development Summit of 25th September 2015, with 17 sustainable development goals and targets and indicators, what is it that we are trying to achieve? We want to end poverty, fight inequality, injustice, tackle climate change by 2030. They are all nothing but goals and targets to help us achieve developmental objectives in the developing world. However, achieving these would require collective efforts, as no one single country is in a position to address these daunting challenges alone. Hence, the imperatives of development cooperation along the Silk Road, reinforced by the members through their respective regional groupings, is important. And this is further amplified due to the fact that certain challenges are cross-country in nature, and those related to the climate change and connectivity, especially in the context of landlockedness. Now, for this to happen, which means to achieve SDGs along the Silk Road, kindly allow me to highlight a framework on which I have been working over the years, and it is coming to some maturity. Regional economic integration needs to focus simultaneously, and I underscore simultaneously, both on peace and prosperity. It is important for economic regionalism among developing countries, particularly along the Silk Road, including South and Central Asia, including South Asia because of India and other South Asian countries. Now, while the causality between peace and prosperity runs in both the directions, and obviously, the narrative has largely remained that peace precedes prosperity. Means, if you don't have peace, you cannot cooperate for economic prosperity. Now, this logic has its own merit, but what I'm trying to argue is it may be about time that a reverse causality is focused, whereby enabling conditions for economic prosperity is created through economic integration to achieve peace. And this is a long haul. It is possible there will be obstructions, there will be violence, but we should not be deterred by that. And what I am trying to argue is that we need to address violence through strategic and other modes of, mechanisms of cooperation among nations. But at the same time, It is very important that we cooperate economically simultaneously. Why do I say this? I say this because of the argument that underdevelopment and unemployment could be one of the origins of instabilities and violence. Unemployed and underprivileged, especially the educated youth, may be prone to adopting unfair means to earn a livelihood. Providing productive employment opportunities to them through scaling up economic activities with the help of economic integration could well ensure prosperity, economic prosperity, which is peace creating. Market access provides an additional demand impulse facilitated by a more liberalized trade regime on a regional basis. This, in turn, contributes to scale expansion in various sectors, including manufacturing. And scale expansion is often referred to as trade creation and trade diversion. Rather than going into that details, I would only say because of scale expansion through trade liberalization and regional cooperation initiatives, you have greater opportunities of people to get employed in all the sectors of the economy, agriculture, industry, and services. If we calibrate tariff and trade integration in goods and services combined with investment in a manner that it creates more opportunities. And once those more opportunities are there, there will be people who would actually go to earn their livelihoods by tapping those opportunities rather than getting swayed by those who want to drag them into violence, you know, and means of income generation which may not be ethical. So with this, I would end that we need to adopt an integrated approach in terms of trade in goods, trade in services, and investment. And this integrated approach on a regional basis, concentrated, should focus on attaining material well-being, economic well-being, which can help solve some of the problems of non-material domains like violence, which basically emanates from unemployment because there are people who can be misutilized and there is a reserve army of labor. Now, one may be reminded, however, that there is nothing automatic about prosperity ensuring peace. It needs to be constantly worked upon, even if there is a high probability of peace creating prosperity. Why have I focused on regional, especially Silk Road? Why did it enchant me in the context of SDGs? Because these have implications for interregional and the global. And that is why I keep saying that you think globally, prosper regionally, and collaborate and connect interregionally by unifying trade, investment, and technology. That could well become a strategy which will well be peace creating through prosperity generation, through regional cooperation, especially in the context of sustainable development goals along the countries of the Silk Road. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Professor. As you could see, Professor was speaking not about competition among participants of different routes of Silk Road, but about cooperation for sustainable development. It's absolutely correct. Many economists looking for different routes of Silk Road through Russia, Ukraine, Turkey, and of course Kazakh territory as a competitive route. In fact, even with incorporation of new routes like through Tehran and through Kyrgyz, through Indian territory, these routes have to be seen as a cooperation for improvement of global prosperity and standard of living of at least two-thirds of global population, which related to Silk Road. And from this point of view, I am very happy to introduce Khaldun Yevash, Secretary General of Khazar Strategy Institute. 3 years ago, together with Khaldun, I had the pleasure and honor to participate at inaugural meeting of Khazar Institute in Ankara. Oh, sorry, you will be next.
Okay, good.
And now I am my pleasure to introduce you.
Good afternoon, Excellencies and dear participants.
I greatly appreciate Turkic Academy for hosting such a wonderful event. Hazar Strategy Institute is an Istanbul-based think tank that focuses on the energy, economy, and security issues of the broader Caspian region. By the way, when Professor Quint mentioned, he's the name father of our institute. What I mean as a name father is that we call our institute, we used to call our institute as Caspian Strategy Institute. And when he attended 3.5 years ago to one of our Caspian forum, he called our institute Hazar Strategy Institute. And just a few months ago, we changed our name to from Caspian Strategy Institute to Hazar Strategy Institute. So I greatly appreciate for Professor Vladimir Kvint. We have been working on Silk Road through the Caspian Transit Corridor for almost 2 years. We have published some reports based on these field work and workshops. You can find on your desks one of our publications, which we published with Turkic Academy during last year's Astana Forum. Based on our work that we did so far, I can easily say that Silk Road through the Caspian Transit Corridor has a great potential to create synergy for the broader Caspian region. Silk Road through the Caspian Transit Corridor has already been contributing to reach the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development Goals. It helps diversification of transport routes through Eurasia. It provides access to new markets in the broader Caspian region. It consists intermodal and multimodal transportation system. It provides faster delivery from Northwest China to Europe. It contributes the Caspian region countries to diversify their economies. It bolsters intra and inter-regional trade. We can count more. But I would like to move to the global perspective for a while and then get back to the Caspian Transit Corridor again. Developing countries multiplied their exports when they became a part of the global economy. East Asian countries gradually adapted to the global economy. They lifted trade barriers systematically and carefully. They utilized globalization to expand their exports and to create new jobs to reduce poverty. On the other hand, there's a fact that global economy is having a problem, which is making global systems more vulnerable against potential conflicts. Slowdown in economy, oil glut, increased defense spending, refugee crisis, radical terror are some of the major challenges that impact the entire world. Civil wars are posing formidable threats to involve greater powers to engage in a proxy war. The decline in oil prices does not carry only an economic means, but rather a greater problem of potential instability and conflicts. So far, emerging economies were the primary drivers of the global economic growth. However, decline in the economic growth makes it a question mark for the future. Uncertainties are urging countries to seek new military and economic alliances in order to balance and deter possible threats, but this would rather lead to worsening of the multilateral relations. We all should rather focus on the economic solution that involves collaboration on the basis of that's not a zero-sum game. Yes, the picture is not all that grim. There are some positive developments, such as removal of sanctions against Iran, increasing consciousness over climate change, and creating synergy along the Silk Road for Agenda 2030 is a major step. Making Caspian Transit Corridor an active route should be accepted as an important milestone to reach Agenda 2030. I advise this point to be included as a recommendation of this symposium, because the milestone has capacity to transform potential negatives into definite positives. This would not be only transit of goods from A to B, but a comprehensive development of trade and production connections
across the routes. This may serve as a bridge of knowledge exchange and innovation sharing among us. There is a high potential along the Silk Road in terms of economic growth and trade volumes. Since inclusion of the Asian countries into the world economy, trends in global trade have changed and trade routes began to concentrate along the Silk Road. Transportation is crucial for continuous trade between countries and regions. Silk Road countries such as Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia, Turkey, and China have been investing for regional connectivity. Trade volumes between Asia and Europe will continue to increase. Countries along the Silk Road lie at the heart of transport routes. Therefore, it is of vital importance to improve transport infrastructure and connectivity of this region to create an uninterrupted trade route between Asia-Pacific and Europe. Investments on this route to improve transport infrastructure and to complete key transport facilities play a crucial role for further development of trade. In that sense, coordination and collaboration among Silk Road countries and international community should be achieved to accelerate efforts and to take necessary steps for regional connectivity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Secretary General. It's very interesting, and we all speaking about salvation of conflicts in Silk Road area, and particular this issue will be topic of speech of Professor Timur Kasaglı from Michigan State University. You're welcome, Professor.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Vladimir Queen. Dear distinguished guests, I would like to congratulate the International Turkic Academy and its president, Professor Darhan Kıdırali, for gathering here at the United Nations building. Distinguished diplomats, scholars, and also the leaders and representatives of various organizations. I'm also very honored to be here with the distinguished scholars Aziz Sancar, Kemal Karpat, and especially Edward Alward, who was my MA and PhD mentor at Columbia University. Central Asia, which I learned from Professor Alward, and its wider form of Central Eurasia, a landlocked region in the heart of Asia and Europe, had been isolated from world politics for the last four centuries as a result of the military expansions and colonization from the mid-16th century to the last decade of the 20th century. From ancient times until the mid-16th century, however, Central Asia and Central Eurasia have been situated in the center of the old Silk Road or Silk Route, which was an ancient network of trade routes that were central to both economic and cultural interaction through various regions, from east to west, from north to south, during the course of the history. This Silk Road provided not only the exchanges of trading goods, but also of different cultures, different philosophies, different religions, different languages, different political thoughts, arts, architecture, and science. In short, the Old Silk Road was the most significant tool for many civilizations which cannot be developed and be sustained without this Old Silk Road. Central Asia and the wider Central Eurasia, however, has re-emerged in the world politics since the demise of the Soviet Union at the end of the 1991. The new independent states of the former Soviet republics have all proved their ability to sustain their statehood despite various difficulties that they have encountered so far in the last 25 years. because of various external players with different degrees of influence and national agendas, the five Central Asian republics, together with Azerbaijan and other former Soviet republics, may realize soon that they have to combine their resources and strengths to form at least a strategic regional alliance among themselves in order to survive big challenges that they face today and they may face in the near future. Any coalition or grouping among the republics of Central Asia and Azerbaijan and other new states, however, depends on the great part on their understanding of each other's national interests, as well as their friendly relations with the all countries surrounding them. There are many political, economic, and environmental challenges facing all the Central Asia as well as Central Eurasian states. The man-made disaster of the dying Aral Sea is just one of them. The need to save the shrinking Aral Sea, on the other hand, gives an opportunity to all Central Asian states to combine their resources and willingness on this problem. The cultural roots of today's Central Asian and Central Eurasian states and its peoples go back to the old Silk Road. Their geostrategic location in the central crossroads of both Asia, Europe, and Northern Africa has not lost its importance at present day too. The Central Eurasian states could play a significant role as vital deterrents for many major conflict or clash between the great powers of Russia, China, US, India, and the EU. I believe Central Asia and Central Eurasia will be a good reply to the controversial claim of the clash of civilizations. In contrary, Central Eurasia could be a source of cooperation of the civilizations for the world peace. Thank you very much.
For your very inspired speech. In conclusion, what I would like to say, all speakers at our panel was underlying a role of Silk Road and cooperation among the Silk Road nations. But what is important to understand that project of this scale required huge amount of money. As I mentioned in my book, it's required roughly $800 billion. So far, we have only China's Silk Road Fund with $40 billion for loans and investment. It's not good enough. What is necessary? Nobody will invest in project of this scale without unified cross-regional strategy, which will encompass not only countries, but regions of these countries and even corporations allocated and operates in these countries. I am very sorry that on our panel there is no representative of China, because China is the most significant country in terms of national strategy development. So far, China is the only country which has 100-year strategy and now working with 200-year strategy, national holistic strategy. And this experience, sectoral, regional, have some other countries of Silk Road, and cooperation in development of such a unified strategy of Silk Road development will really increase standard of living of all people of Silk Road influence. Thank you for this participation, and thank you for listening to our speeches. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Professor. Our moderators and panelists did an amazing job, and I would like to reiterate why we are here. I'd like to reiterate the importance of this symposium, if you allow me. And then there will be a family photo, and there will be a reception co-hosted by His Excellency Ambassador Rimmel Hasanov, Secretary General of the Turkey Council, and His Excellency Darhan Kadreli, President of International Turkic Academy, in honor of participants of the symposium. Don't forget, and please come. It is going to be, again, at the UN headquarters, right here, on the fourth floor at the West Terrace. But let's go back to the Silk Road. Two more minutes, please. At present stage, the revival of the Silk Road has gained further prominence as a factor contributing to the diversification of economies of the region. China and the countries in the region and Europe, they're all making serious efforts to develop a sustainable infrastructure, ensuring intermodal transport that can transform the flow of global and regional trade, as well as the production of the goods. There are presently a number of remarkable examples of projects and steps that are being taken, as all of our panelists told us. Some of them are the Silk Road Economic Belt, or otherwise it's called as One Belt, One Road, a development strategy and framework proposed by the People's Republic of China. And that focuses on connectivity and cooperation among countries, primarily in Eurasia. The Middle Corridor is another one. The Middle Corridor linking Turkey and the International Transit Corridor, a road corridor linking Europe and Asia being developed by the World Bank. Another one, Kars Akal Kalaki Tbilisi Baku Railway. That's a regional rail link to directly connect Turkey, Georgia, and Azerbaijan. Another one, Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline, a natural gas pipeline under the auspices of the Asian Development Bank. Another one, seaport investments by Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, and Turkmenistan, Transanatolian natural gas pipeline, and Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, and many others that you spelled out. All of these transformed the ancient Great Silk Road into a modern intercontinental connectivity network. This is the message, but there is more. Furthermore, long-standing experience of fostering cultural cohesion and tolerance in the region contributes and should contribute to achieving inclusive development. So, what is the United Nations' role in all of this? This high-level symposium entitled Synergies Along the Silk Road for Agenda 2030 seeks to highlight the important role the region can play in advancing the initiatives spearheaded by the United Nations. The countries of the region are deeply and need to be deeply engaged as catalysts, partners, and supporters of these initiatives supported by the United Nations. I know you did an amazing job to summarize this, but this is the whole conclusion, and thank you so much for putting all your valuable input, feelings, spiritual words, participants, His Excellencies, Her Excellencies, thank you so much for your attendance and also your support. I hope you're all having a wonderful day. Don't forget to go to the reception. But before that, we'll have a family photo. This is our tradition at Hasan and at other organizations. First, with all of the academicians, and I would like to invite TWESCO's President, His Excellency, Mr. Darhan Kadreli here. And I would like to invite all our academicians once more. I'm going to make you walk again, but Professor Aziz Sanjar, Professor Kemal Karparts, Professor Edward Allward, please come to the podium once more.